Tantor Audio, the division of Recorded Books, presents Even Brook Trout Get the Blues by John Gierach, narrated by David Colacci. Motivation, if it ever existed as an agent in human affairs, is completely shagged out now. What drives people is a lot woolier than motivation. Martin Amis. Not everything is known about fly fishermen. As the researchers say, further study is indicated. Charles Waterman. 1. Farm ponds. I think the first fish I ever caught was a bluegill from a pond on my uncle's farm in Indiana, but I can't be absolutely sure. You'd think that would be something you'd never forget, like any number of other firsts I could mention. But although that memory would be no more than about 40 years old now, it has become obscured by subsequent fish, of which I have to say there have been quite a few. I suppose my first fish could just as easily have been a little bullhead from the creek at home, but there's something about that pond I can't get out of my mind. I remember it as small, so given the propensity of things from childhood to loom larger than they really were, it must have been tiny, maybe a few acres at the most. There were cattails growing at the shallow end, and the water near the dike was deep enough to swim in, though I never thought it was all that inviting. There were too many weeds and sticks that seemed to want to grab you, and there was this morbid curiosity I had about what else might be down there. I never did get to be much of a swimmer. The pond stood out in the open, not far from the house, a low, unimpressive disk of water you could see from a long way off. Its banks were grazed over pasture, trampled to mud, and there were no trees for shade. The water was clear, though. I can remember wading in the shallows and watching the crawdads skitter along the bottom in front of me. Usually I'd spot their trails of silt first, then the creatures themselves. Eventually I overcame my fear of the pincers enough to try and catch them by hand, at least the little ones that were around in the spring. It wasn't easy. There wouldn't have been much in the way of natural structure in the pond. It was set in a shallow draw with a seasonal stream running through it, so the bottom would have been shaped like an elongated bowl. But I think I recall Uncle Leonard sinking some old tires and brush in there for fish habitat. Leonard was a serious fisherman and knew about those things. I don't think they referred to it as structure then. I think they just called it old tires and slash. They didn't call it habitat either. They just said the fish liked it. One thing I remember clearly is the electric fence you had to cross to get to the pond. Uncle Leonard, being an advocate of one trial learning, let me go ahead and touch it so I'd know why I was being told not to touch it. Leonard once told me, "Dogs and kids aren't good with ideas, but they learn well from experience." In the beginning, at least, I fished the pond with a stick, string, and worm, along with my cousins Rod and Shorty, Roger and Norma Jean, to company. All we knew about fishing was, if you put a worm on a hook and sank it in the water, a fish might eventually come along and eat it. We didn't understand that exactly where in the water, let alone when, might make a difference. Mostly we got little sunfish, and not too many of those. I know now that's because we mostly fished in the wrong places, and because we usually did it in the middle of the day, at the worst possible time. Leonard, of course, had the thing wired. He'd go out to the pond by himself and come back in an hour or so with enough big bass for supper. These were fish of a size and kind I'd never gotten myself, even though I'd spent a fair amount of time on the same pond. They also reinforced that suspicion that kept me from wanting to swim, the idea that there were things in the water you might not know about. I was astonished. Clearly, there was more to all this than I'd thought. Leonard fished in the evenings when it was cool and the light was off the water, or sometimes at night when we kids were getting ready to go to bed. We assumed he went out then, because that was when the work was finished. Sometimes he used worms, just like we did, but there were also minnows, crawdads, frogs, grubs, crickets, and grasshoppers in evidence from time to time. He said that, yes, the kind of bait could make a difference, but added, "That ain't all there is to it." Right. I could see that. And sometimes he used these plugs with shiny metal scoops and blades on them and painted eyes and scales. Except for the dangling hooks, they had the bright look of toys. I liked them a lot, but although I could see they were supposed to be frogs or minnows, I couldn't believe a fish would actually mistake them for the real thing. Unless this was some kind of elaborate joke, which was always a possibility, Leonard must be right when he said, "Fish don't think like we do." Eventually, Leonard showed me how it was done. Or rather, he let me come along and watch and pick up what I could, provided I could keep quiet and stay more or less out of the way. He'd never lecture, but he'd try to answer whatever questions I felt like asking, because the type of question would indicate how much information I was able to absorb. That way I didn't get confused, and he didn't have to talk any more than was absolutely necessary. Actually, Leonard was quite a talker most of the time, but on the water he'd go into a trance-like silence for long periods of time. Adults still tell kids to be quiet so they don't scare the fish, but that's not the real reason. It's just hard to explain to a child that a kind of profound physical and mental stillness is required if you want to catch fish. That's one of those things you have to come to on your own. Anyway, I learned not to chatter, and also to choose my questions well and ask them quietly. Sometimes Leonard would pay me the supreme compliment of saying, "I don't know," instead of making something up, although he could make up some great stuff when he was in the mood. If anything, I appreciate that even more now than I did then, but it still sticks in my mind as one of the first times an adult was honest with me. There were some years in there when all I wanted to do in the summer was go see Uncle Leonard. That hung on for a while even after my family moved to Minnesota and there was some distance involved. The trips were fewer and farther between then, but they meant a ride on the Vista Dome Limited from Minneapolis to Chicago, a classy train from the days when people really traveled that way. These were my first long journeys alone, and if anyone asked, I didn't say I was going to visit my uncle. I said I was going fishing. I was 11 or 12 years old by then, and I felt pretty damned worldly. I'd always gotten along with Leonard, but when my dad and I eventually got into the normal bad times fathers and sons go through, I got interested in the difference between him and my uncle. It didn't occur to me until years later that the main difference was one was an uncle and the other was a dad. Two positions with very singular job descriptions. I always felt like Leonard was telling me the truth as he saw it, while Dad was making what I now see as the classic mistake of telling me the world was, in fact, the way he thought it should be. The evidence for his position was not always compelling, and there was a time when I thought my father was, if not a liar, then at least a propagandist. Dad would sometimes tell me what I would, by God, do when I got older, because that's what everyone did, while Leonard, when he said anything at all, tended to allow that I'd do what I thought was best when the time came. The only limp advice Leonard ever gave me had to do with a girl I went to high school with whom I wanted to seduce. I don't remember exactly what he said, but it was seriously out of character, some kind of obligatory version of what he knew Dad would have said if I dared to ask him about it, namely, "Keep it in your pants because everyone your age keeps it in his pants," even though we both knew everyone didn't. It was an awkward moment for both of us. I finally realized that Dad was an idealist. I came to respect him for that in time, became something of an idealist myself, and saw how that can make you impatient. On the other hand, Leonard once told me he didn't care if a guy was an idealist or a Presbyterian as long as he pulled his own weight. Interestingly enough, both of these guys were good fishermen. In later years, I would come to understand the concept of sport, but a farmer in the Midwest of the 1950s had a somewhat different perspective on recreation. That is, he viewed everything he did as a chore, although he'd admit that some chores were more enjoyable than others. When he picked up his rod, Leonard would usually say something like, "Well, I guess I better go fishing," in the same tone of voice he'd use for, "I guess I'd better get that tire changed." The job here was to collect supper, and the only fish Leonard ever released, threw back, that is, were the ones that were too little to keep. When he got as many as he wanted, he'd quit. To him, fish were a crop that just happened to be fun to harvest, and I think it delighted him to be able to cheat the work ethic that way. To me, fun was fun, although when it was done in the company of an adult and the gratification wasn't immediate, there did seem to be a deeper meaning to it. There were these big fish in there that you could get if you did everything just right, and doing it right could be different today than it was yesterday. Furthermore, there were days when the adult couldn't figure it out any better than I could, and that gave me my first hint that I was not, in fact, stupid, as I often felt around grown-ups, but that the world was just a complex place where, as Leonard said, "Some days you get the elevator, and some days you get the shaft." Occasionally there were some very large bass. I won't try to guess at their size now, because I was young and small then, and this was a long time ago, but some of them were big enough to scare me a little, even though I still wanted them badly. The fine balance between those two emotions was delicious, and toothy fish like pike and big trout still do that to me. The rod, reel, and line become not only instruments for catching fish, but also a way to keep some of these things at a safe distance until you can grab them just right. It was one of those great mysteries that take hold of you early in life, and so I grew up to be one of those who, for better or worse, take their fishing seriously. Consequently, I got into fly fishing, an area where considerations of sport come before those of practicality. I believe I stopped short of becoming a snob, though, and I think I owe that to farm ponds. These little puddles filled with panfish and surrounded by cows teach you early on that fishing is not necessarily a fine art. Farm ponds are a standard fixture in rural America, as ordinary and necessary as barns and barbed wire. You need water for the stock, so you dam a creek or dike up a swale to make a pond. In drier country, you might have to sink a well and erect a windmill, or capture irrigation water. There's a science to this, not to mention volumes of water law. You have to know about drainages, soils, and dike construction, and you have to be sure you actually have the rights to the water in the first place. Here in the West, wars were fought over that kind of thing. They're still being fought, for that matter, but now people use lawyers instead of rifles, which makes it even nastier. Once you had your pond, you naturally tossed some fish in it, probably bluegills and largemouth bass, the two most common warm water farm pond fish in the U.S., although other combinations have been known to work, too, and in cooler water you could stock trout. You did this because you were a farmer or a rancher, and so you were in favor of self-sufficiency and against waste. This seems to be a genetic predisposition. There's something in the collective rural American consciousness that abhors a fishless body of water. Some other things would probably arrive on their own in time, things like frogs, the eggs of which might be carried in stuck to the legs of herons. These birds might have dropped by the first year to see what was up, and found a largely sterile body of water, although if they came back the next spring, there'd be fresh tadpoles to eat. Many of the aquatic insects would arrive under their own power, while cattail seeds, and maybe the seeds of some trees as well, came via the wind. No one knows where the bullheads came from, but they were always there. Someone once said the entire earth is covered with dormant bullhead eggs that hatch as soon as they get wet. It's a case of what John Cole calls natural persistence. We humans try to control things, but for better or worse, the natural process moves in as soon as your back is turned to show you you're not entirely in charge. Anyway, the dike was built, the water pooled, and the organisms that liked it showed up in their own good time. To each new arrival, the place became irreplaceable overnight, as if it had been there for 100,000 years. And as long as a pond held water year-round, it would gradually soften at the edges and begin to go wild. A three-generation-old farm pond, one that has attracted cottonwood trees, ducks, muskrats, and such, can be almost indistinguishable from a small natural lake. If you happen to enjoy fishing, a dock may have sprouted just as naturally, and sooner or later you'd probably barter yourself into a small boat of some kind. Not a bass boat or anything like that. You'd want a good workable fish pond and a boat to match, but this was not what you'd call a big-ticket operation. All you needed was some old wooden scow that would stay afloat for a couple hours in the evening. When the boat finally waterlogged and sank, you might have gotten a new one and left the old wreck on the bottom, planning to dispose of it properly when you got around to it. But there'd be lots of more important things to do, and in time the gunwales would become a faint outline down there in the weeds and muck. Given enough neglect, the boat would finally dissolve altogether, saving you a couple hours of muddy work. If you were like the farmers I remember from my childhood, you wouldn't take the pond too seriously or get too fancy about it, but you'd probably manage it some in an effort to grow the biggest, healthiest fish possible. You might even go to the trouble of calling the county extension agent for advice and then buying some fish from a hatchery. Then again, that would cost money, so maybe you'd just catch a few bucketfuls of fish in another pond and haul them in, figuring if they took, they'd be free, and if they didn't, you wouldn't have wasted any money. Money was precious, but work was just work. There was an endless supply of it. You'd fish the pond yourself when you had time, for kicks, a good free meal, or both. Your kids, and maybe a young nephew, would catch their first fish there, and if you were a nice guy, you might let the occasional stranger fish it as well, if he asked nicely and looked okay. That's how most of us came to farm ponds as adults. We ask around or just knock on strange doors and humbly ask to fish. It doesn't always work, but if we're polite and don't look like mass murderers, it works often enough. Maybe you spotted the pond while driving through farm country on your way somewhere else. There may have been fish rising in it, or maybe it just seemed right somehow. A good pond can have a certain look to it, although it's hard to describe exactly what that entails. Vegetation, shade, and flooded trees are all good signs, but beyond that, there's this kind of beckoning green warmth about it, like the collective auras of 50 largemouth bass hovering over the water. Whatever it is, it's sometimes possible to spot it in a split second at 1,000 yards from the window of a speeding automobile. I've known fishermen to do considerable research on farm ponds and private reservoirs, consulting county maps, aerial photos, and tax records. Often people who go to that kind of trouble are looking for something to lease, but not always. Some of them are just hunting for something that's great because it's obscure, and they understand you can't see every farm pond in America from a public road. Of course, there are fishermen who won't look at farm ponds twice, probably because they're sometimes not very pretty as bodies of water go. These would be the same guys who go somewhere exotic, catch lots of huge fish in some lush wilderness, and then claim they're spoiled for anything less. People who have forgotten that, although fishing can be an adventure, it is basically just an ordinary, everyday aspect of a good life. To me, it's the very homeliness of farm ponds that makes them so tantalizing. Some ponds are so well camouflaged that no one pays much attention to them, and so, when the conditions are right, populations of virtually wild fish can just percolate in there, growing larger and larger and not getting especially smart. In this way, a seedy little farm pond is more of a natural setting than a highly regulated catch-and-release trout stream. If you stay in one part of the country long enough, you might be able to develop a modest network of farm ponds that you can get on. You'll end up with some good, easy-going fishing close to home, and in private moments you can congratulate yourself for being cagey and connected in the finest tradition of the local fisherman. It'll help if you're not too shy about asking, and if you can take rejection gracefully. It's a cardinal rule of farm ponds that if the man says no, then no it is, and he doesn't even have to explain why. Now and then money will change hands, and I don't think money is dirty in this context, though often the exchange is something more personal, like some cleaned fish or a six-pack. This all fits in nicely with my personal vision of what a fisherman should be. He can be classy if he likes, but beneath that he's funky, rural, practical, and not unacquainted with hard work. By that, I mean he may not actually do hard work, but he at least knows it when he sees it, which in turn means he knows enough to close the gates behind him without being told. And most of all, he's not entirely blinded by the scenery and the trappings. Sure, he can have a weakness for trout and big, pretty rivers, but if it's cows and chickens wandering around the banks of a pond, rather than, say, mule deer and blue grouse, then so be it. If the fish don't care, why should he? My friends and I will usually show up at a farm pond all decked out for high sport with neoprene waders, belly boats, fly rods, cameras, the whole thing. We remember when it was different, but this is just how we do it now. We have become fly fishermen. Between us, we carry fly patterns that imitate just about any warm water food organism you can name, plus those goofy things that have what pass for anatomical features, but that nonetheless look like nothing nature has ever produced on this planet. After all, fish don't think like we do. Sometimes we'll take the temperature of the water. Someone usually knows what the barometer is doing at the moment, and there may be talk of water chemistry, aquatic vegetation, moon phase, photo periods as they relate to spawning and feeding activity, insect migration patterns, and so on. Now and then the owner of the pond will be impressed. More likely, he'll be amused and a little puzzled, wondering how we got it into our heads that anything, let alone fishing, was that complicated. 2. Trout candy. The phone started ringing on Wednesday afternoon. The news had an urgent tone to it, but it was also vague. Either the willow flies were on over at the Colorado River and the fishing was great, or someone thought the flies should be on by now, or there was a third or fourth-hand report that they had been on a day or two ago. Something like that. Something about the willow flies. This is how it usually begins. The weather was damp and nasty. A low-pressure front was stalled over the northern Colorado Rockies, and I was down with a spring cold, or maybe a dose of the latest strain of flu, so I was slow to catch the enthusiasm. My friend A.K. Best wanted me to drive over there with him on Thursday on the off chance there was some substance to the reports. In fact, he insisted on it. A.K., you see, is one of those guys who has actually fished this hatch in its glory. Like other fishermen in this same small fraternity, he claims he's never been quite the same since, so now he's a kind of evangelist for it. He and Coke Winter hit it once 16 years ago on the Big Hole River in Montana, and I've heard about it so many times now I can almost see it myself. The big flies flopping around on the surface of the river, the huge trout rising to eat them, the slurping of the fish audible over the background noise of the current, and the tip-off as these two men, then from Michigan, drove down the highway along the river. Some of the large, clumsy flies had formed up in an egg-laying flight over the road, thinking the black, shiny asphalt was water. They hit the windshield like sparrows. The dry fly fishing that day had been great. I mean, you know, great. The story is well rehearsed by now, and these two guys are normally articulate, but on this subject, they reach a point where words fail. As cosmopolitan as fly fishing has gotten in recent years, it still has some regional characteristics. Up there in Montana, the bug in question is known as a stonefly, presumably because the nymphal form of the insect lives under large stones on the stream beds. Large stones, but not small ones. No telling why. In some other places, the same bug is a salmon fly, possibly because of its body color. Here in Colorado, it's the willow fly, because the inch-and-a-half-long winged adults can be found hanging in those bushes along the river. The big stone flies spend almost all their lives, up to 3 years, which is long for a bug, as aquatic nymphs hunting and foraging along the bottoms of trout streams. They grow steadily, molt repeatedly, and are regularly eaten by trout. In the right streams and rivers, a big stonefly nymph pattern fished near the bottom in deep water is the first thing most fly fishermen will try. Many large trout are caught this way. Stoneflies are such a dependable and nutritious food source that a good stonefly stream is usually a good trout stream, too. The insects are also an indicator species for stream biologists. They need cold, clean, highly oxygenated water, and their presence means good water quality. When a generation of stonefly nymphs reaches maturity, they migrate to shallow water, climb out under rocks, logs, and bridge pilings, crack their nympha husks, and hatch into winged insects. Scientists say emerge, while many fly fishermen still prefer hatch. It's less accurate, but traditional. After the bugs have mated, the females return to the stream, lay their eggs on the water, and fall to the surface, spent. Many are then eaten by trout. This would be every bit as poignant as the mayfly's well-known one tragic night of romance, except that mayflies are delicate and pretty, while stoneflies are big and horrible. When they made that movie back in the 1950s, where giant radioactive grasshoppers took over the world, they missed a good bet by not using stoneflies instead. Next to a stonefly, a grasshopper looks cuddly. Technically speaking, and fly fishermen can get annoyingly technical, there's more than one species involved here, but for all practical purposes, it's the same insect. Larger than a grasshopper, unattractive, even dangerous looking, unpredictable in its habits, and the ultimate in trout candy. The sport of fly fishing is grounded in the fact that trout feed primarily on insects, and the large members of the stonefly family are the biggest ones they ever see. Fish are said to go mad when the oversized flies are on the water. The biggest brown and rainbow trout in the river, the ones only bait fishermen ever see, are said to rise gaily to the surface like young sunfish. You can catch enormous trout on dry flies until your rod arm hurts. It's almost too easy, they say, although they always say that in an ironic tone of voice. Fly fishing, you see, is supposed to be a very difficult and painstaking business in which success can be rare and fleeting and with complex philosophical undercurrents. That's the sport's main attraction, and it's also the reason why so many of its practitioners are such misanthropes. We don't actually hate society. We just feel like we're plugged into something larger, better, and more interesting, so that the more alienated we become on the one hand, the more at home we feel on the other. Fishing is engrossing because it's so lovely, and that's central to everything. We try to be logical, but there's no way around it. We end up believing in whatever we think is beautiful, whether we can prove it makes sense or not. Everyone needs something wonderful in their life that they can't explain, and that they might not explain even if they could. There's even a moral aspect. A fisherman, especially a flycaster who doesn't keep many fish, addresses the environment in what he feels is the only right way, not as a spoiler or an observer, but as a responsible participant who tries not to want much more than he honestly needs. It's easy to see how a guy like this could look at day-to-day life in America and begin to feel a little superior. In fact, fishing is fairly difficult over the long haul. Success involves the exquisite timing of hitting the hatches just right, the foresight to have the right fly patterns, and then at least some skill to take advantage of the situation. And naturally, the best fishing is usually in the worst weather. Those of us who have stuck with it for a long time, catching some fish in the process, take pride in that. We're also proud that this is a sport to which lives are dedicated. We say dedicated, others say wasted or even pissed away. Fly fishing can be expensive and time-consuming. It induces fits of solitary contemplation and requires a lot of travel. And since most of the fish caught are released, it seems like a strangely beautiful but otherwise pointless thing to do. Sort of like art. And, as with artists, there's a mythology about the sacrifices and personal costs of being a fly fisherman. A friend tells this story about a fly fisher's wife. Before they were married, the man told her, truthfully, "I don't drink, take drugs, gamble, or chase women, but I do fly fish." 2 years later, the woman was heard to say, "It sounded good at first, but now I wish he did some of those other things instead." In the full context of the sport, stories of too much fishing causing domestic trouble are better than the ones where huge trout are either caught or lost. Remember, this is all about belief, and without some suffering, both physical and social, belief starts to look frivolous. There are a few people around who still cling to that tired old battle of the sexes routine where the men see fishing as an escape from women and the women see it as a kind of threat, but that really belongs to past generations who never came to grips with passion. There's even a name for it now. Dr. Don Powell of the American Institute of Preventative Medicine recently defined the condition as psychosclerosis, or a hardening of the attitudes. And I should point out, the men who really do fish to escape women don't fish at all. They drink and play cards. Among most fishermen, they are outcasts. There are also some militant amateur head shrinkers around who like to think you fish for dark reasons you don't understand, but that they, of course, do. The rod is your penis, the water is your soul, and the fish are either God or your mother. These are the people who will psychoanalyze you at the dinner table whether you agree to it or not, and if you don't agree to it, it's only because you're terribly repressed. I don't know. Maybe there really are hidden chambers of weirdness lurking beneath what seems obvious, but I think it's actually pretty simple. Fly fishing is a healthy, antisocial sport, and many of us have an emotional investment in being misunderstood because it makes us feel strange and brilliant, like Van Gogh. Maybe that's why, when rumors of a stonefly hatch surface, we have this tendency to drop everything and drive hundreds of miles on the off chance that for once we can catch lots of big trout with almost no effort at all. We've paid our dues. We deserve it. And best of all, there are those who will never understand what all the excitement is about. Those who've experienced it claim it does something to you. Exactly what it does is never clearly specified, but a good stonefly hatch has been compared to the first sexual encounter, or a religious conversion, one of those manifestations that reveal the truth and make your previous life read like someone else's biography. And all this, in aesthetic terms, most people look askance at. Slimy fish, nasty-looking bugs, ice water seeping into waders, etc., which makes it the exclusive thrill of the true connoisseur. Maybe a stonefly hatch changes you, and maybe it doesn't. I have noticed that stonefly types have a kind of free-form intensity the rest of us lack, a kind of faith in something beyond reasonable expectations. These are the guys who would fish long and hard in the settling pond at a sewage treatment plant if that's all that was available. Like cats, they seem to see something the rest of us don't. I don't know if it changed AK or not, because I met him after he'd hit the stonefly hatch in Montana. I can testify, however, that he's a little crazy now. Coke, too. Crazy and happy, which is the time-honored posture of the sport. Anyway, AK insisted that I go over to the Colorado River with him on Thursday, but I said I couldn't because I was sick with a cold or something worse.
"The hell with being sick," he said. "This is important."
There was something like indignant patriotism in his voice, as if I was trying to dodge the draft because of a hangnail.
"Sick," I whined. "Headache, runny nose, hacking cough, fever, depressed, no interest in sex. Sick. I have no urge to drive halfway across the state and stand in an ice-cold river waiting for a hatch that never comes off anyway."
"Okay, but you'll be sorry," AK said.
There are a lot of Western fishermen who know what I mean by that. I'm anything but a stonefly fanatic, but I'm familiar with the mythology, and in the course of things I have pursued these hatches off and on for 15 or 20 years through 4 or 5 Western states on the advice of people I probably shouldn't have trusted. I mean, what if your doctor or your banker had this insane plan with a slim chance of success and a look in his eye to match? Would you say, "Sure, whatever you think is best"? I've been on the water before the hatch came off, and I've arrived just a day or two after it. I've even been there when the big flies were hanging in the bankside brush like mutant seed pods, but weren't on the water where the trout could eat them. Sometimes there were other bugs around, good hatches of mayflies or caddis, and the fishing was great, but in the back of everyone's mind was the suspicion that it wasn't as great as it could have been. I've fished flies, imitating the nymphs, ahead of the hatch, and I've fished the dry flies after it. Trout have been caught, sometimes large ones, but for the mythic event itself, I should have been there 2 days ago, or I should stay another couple of days, because it's just about to happen. I've stayed. It's never happened. I carried the big dry flies in my box for so long the hooks rusted and I threw them away. Then I replaced them with new ones just in case. I like the big bird stonefly pattern because it's an old-time Western standard and because it's quick and easy to tie. There are newer, snazzier patterns around now because the big long-shanked hooks these things are tied on are the kind of large canvases fly tires like. But I can't see spending a lot of time at the vise on flies that are just going to rot away in the box. AK and Coke left early Thursday morning, probably around 4. They'd have been nearing the pass over to the western slope about dawn. I dragged myself up at 9, sniffling and moaning, had some coffee, skimmed some disturbing headlines in the morning Rocky Mountain News, then crawled back to bed and slept until near dark. I dreamed about paddling a canoe with great difficulty through deep shag carpet, and woke up feeling like I was back from the dead. That is, I didn't feel great, but I felt better, as though maybe I'd live after all. I didn't really wish I'd gone fishing, but I did have the feeling that I'd wimped out.
The phone rang that evening.
"Well, we caught some fish, but it wasn't really happening. A few more days should do it. Let's go back on Monday."
The phone continued to ring over the weekend. The word was out, although it still wasn't clear what the word was. There were rumors, lots of contagious excitement, but no one had actually seen or fished the hatch. As it turned out, AK and Coke went back on Monday.
"It almost happened, but not quite. There were a few bugs in the bushes," AK said that evening.
"And I went up on Tuesday with Larry Pogreba and Ed Engel. I was still in a kind of weak, sick fog, but I had to go. This could be it. If I missed it, I'd catch incredible grief from those who didn't. I was heavily medicated and at least ambulatory." We drove to the river in Larry's souped-up vintage Cadillac, a fine luxury hot rod as big inside as an ambulance, with wide leather seats and electric windows. This thing is painted silver, with tastefully pale pink and blue flames coming off the hood and front wheels. A radar detector is Velcroed to the dashboard. It's a fast driver's car, and Larry is a fast driver. He's even done it professionally, although those days, and those injuries, are now history. Still, fast driving becomes a way of life. Larry is a native Westerner who grew up covering large pieces of empty real estate in record time. Out here, that's a matter of homegrown practicality as well as something of a sport. His father was a fighter pilot, and it's been said of Larry that he never quite has enough air under him. We arrived at the town of Hot Sulphur Springs well ahead of schedule, having experienced only a low pucker factor. The pucker factor, expressed as low, moderate, or high, refers to the amount of upholstery a passenger sucks up his rectum due to fear. We rigged up quickly and deployed along the river, Larry below the concrete bridge, Ed and I above. Hot Sulphur is where current logic placed the advancing hatch. A day earlier, according to AK, the bridge pilings were plastered with the dry, nymphal husks of hatched stoneflies. After some wind and rain the previous night, Ed and I found only a few. The day was gray, breezy, and cool, even chilly if you were running a slight fever. It was early June, spring at that altitude, but it had been a dry winter, so the river was only a little off color. This, they were saying, was an excellent omen for the willow fly hatch, which sometimes comes off when the river is sand-colored from the runoff, making the big, luscious bugs all but invisible to the fish. There were a few odd insects on the water, mayflies and caddis, and some trout rose sporadically here and there. We tried our big, dry stonefly patterns first. It said the trout like these bugs so much that once they've seen the real ones, they'll hit the imitations for days after the hatch itself has petered out or moved on. We tried that, but it didn't work. Then Ed tied on a dry caddis imitation, and I tried the mayfly, something to do while waiting for the main event. Before long, Larry came by, fishing the way he drives, that is, hard. He was casting something large, dark, and heavily weighted, probing all the deep holes where the trout should be, and he was moving. In 10 minutes, he disappeared around a bend upriver. About then, some kind of blue sports car peeled up on the dirt road along the far bank. Three guys piled out and began shaking and otherwise examining the bushes for willow flies. Nothing. Then they all stood for a minute watching Ed and me as we stood knee-deep in the river casting dry flies. They were all wondering what any fisherman wonders at a time like that, namely, are those guys oblivious, or do they know something we don't? Then they got in their car and drove off downstream in what would have been a cloud of dust if it hadn't rained the night before. Ed and I wondered if we should follow them, then decided against it.
By early afternoon, we'd all caught a few fish using a variety of nymphs and dry flies. Larry and I had each turned very large trout that we'd seen and felt for an instant before they were gone. The rest of my fish were small, but a few in the foot-long range had been hot enough to take a little line. Ed landed a nice big rainbow on a little dry caddisfly. We were doing okay, catching some fish. We took a break then and walked over to Riverside Flies,
a closet-sized fly shop in the basement of the Riverside Hotel.
The proprietor's name was Ed Bennett. He looked a lot like Richard Brodigan. The three of us stomped in our waders, and I asked, "What's the story on the hatch?" No need to specify which hatch. Bennett looked up from the flawless stonefly nymph he was tying and said, "I don't know." We dedicated a moment of silence to that, as people tend to do when confronted with the simple truth spoken plainly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.